Hello and welcome back to Theoretically Practical. I'm Brent.
Hello.
And this is the Gehl 4610 that I said I was done with in the last video. And
to be fair, it runs, it drives, it works, it does everything it should do. Just doesn't love to start in the cold.
Now, we've talked in previous episodes about the strange sort of spark plug-like thing with that little red wire right there coming off the intake that starts a small fire in the intake with diesel to help you get it started in the cold. And I'm not gonna say it doesn't work. It doesn't work great, and it's hard to tell if you've held it for long enough, and it can burn out if you hold it for too long. And perhaps I just need a new $20 part. But why put $20 into a machine when you could spend more? So what I've been doing to start it lately is I've just been taking this lovely heat gun, putting it right into the air box and turning it on. And when I do this, machine starts instantly, every time, no matter how cold it is, loves it. So I got to thinking, I think, well, I can't, you know, leave a heat gun in there, and I'm not always gonna use this somewhere where it's parked next to power. So what do I do? And also, like, if I sell this thing, you know, just being like, oh yeah, it starts great in the cold, you just gotta put a heat gun to her. It's like, well, yeah, but I'd rather not. So what I got is I got this. And we'll go inside and talk about this a little more. So this is a, and if some of you may recognize this, this is what's called a grid heater, and it's out of a 12-valve Dodge Cummins. And this is the 12-volt version. There's a 12 and 24-volt version. I don't know that they're different necessarily, but I went for the one labeled 12 volts, and I mean, this was $40. Got it on eBay, but it does say Phillips and Temro, Indiana, made in USA. So, and it feels like a good piece of quality kit. So what I have is this, a relay to drive it, a bunch of these to make up the right cables almost right, a bunch of wire. I bought this, I got this at a lot at an auction, which is why I'm using ridiculously oversized, ridiculously nice wire. I would not have gone and bought, you know, whatever $100 roll of wire for this, but I have some 2-gauge wire, or I have 8-gauge wire, and the ampacity chart I looked at says that 4-gauge wire is what I need. So when in doubt, go up a size, and it doesn't actually cost me anything too. So that's what I'm going to do. So what am I going to do with this? Well, I'm going to take this piece of exhaust pipe to be more precise, and it is the same OD as the ID of the inlet tube. So, and I'm going to cut this in half, make 2 plates for this, and bolt that in, bolt the relay to the side of it. This relay, if you get one of these, this needs to be grounded in order for it to work. There's the I and the S. You don't need the I. The S is the only terminal you need. And then put the hot wire through this. So it's kind of convenient because this can go on the wall of the machine or somewhere where I probably where I already have a bolt. This is going to be on the same side of the machine as the starter. So I already got a big power cable coming from the battery there. I've got enough room on the starter that I can add another lug, so that'll be the wire for this. And it should be really, really simple. And then I just have to take the wire off the current hot start method that's this, or the one that's there, and put it right there. And then this thing should work okay. I bet I don't have the bolts here for that, but we'll figure it out as we go. So the real first step is going to be to cut 2 pieces of plate to plate over the top and bottom. I really want to do this out of aluminum, but I couldn't get aluminum, so it's gonna be out of steel. I've got my little mill, which might make a show here, but probably I'll probably weld this on and drill it out with the biggest drill I've got, and then just take a die grinder and open her up. Well, I think I'm gonna use 1/8-inch plate because I have some. So yeah, we'll come back to that in just a minute.
Well, at least I got one of these the right size. This one fits good. This one, I think I went on the wrong side of a line. But for what we're doing with this, it's not going to have to hold any particular pressure. I think it'll be just fine anyways. I wish I had cut it 1/8 of an inch wider, but them's the brakes. It's not that big of a deal. All right, We got a little piece of pipe cut up. I cleaned them up. I got as much of the galvanization off the end as I could. I'm working in a shop with both bay doors open, so just be careful when you're welding exhaust pipe. It's got galvanization on it. It's not good for you. Say it's a perfect weld, but for me it's all right, and it's definitely going to be airtight, so I'm happy with this for the moment. I'm gonna weld up the other one and then I'll go to drilling the holes. See you in a minute. All right, guys, we're making some good progress on this. So this is what I have now. You know, it's just two plates on either side, hole down the middle, grid heater inside. I have no idea if this will work. It's just what I wanted to do it. So next thing I do is cut this piece of hose. I'm gonna cut some out of the middle, but not quite the full width of this, because as I look at it, the straight section is just barely long enough. So if I only cut like an inch out of this, the other thing I gotta fight with is it's got a coil spring in the middle to keep it from suctioning down, I think, if the air filter's clogged. So I just gotta keep an eye on that, and when I cut the ends of this, I'm gonna have to bend them over, not as clean as this, but just so that they don't end up sliding in here and touching those grids, because I can't imagine that would be the best scenario. So I'm gonna dig up some cutting stuff. I know I got some cutting stuff somewhere that'll do that. And yeah, we'll get that fitted, and then we'll install this back on the machine, and then we get to play with these, for which I do not have the correct crimper, and see how well we can get these hooked up. Run some extraordinarily oversized. I'm still not sold on this wire. I might go to 8 gauge because I have it. I just don't think it's necessary. I don't know. I'm going to think on that. I'm going to get this fit. I'm going to bolt this together, put a little bit of gasket sealant on the flanges to keep it airtight. And yeah, we'll be right back. Now, looking at how much of this length is going to be held up by this tube, I think I'm going to leave the spring out, because that just solves a lot of problems for me. So this is the engine end. This is that end. Perfect. Yeah, so there we go. Inline grid heater. Step one of many. Alrighty, let's go install this on the machine, and then we can start our wiring, which is not that involved. I'd say that looks damn decent. Now I just gotta tighten up the hose clamps, and we'll be golden. If I go around to this side, I can get at the other side of it real easily. So I'd say on the whole, that's good enough. So I'm gonna tighten those up and then measure some wire lengths, and then I'll be right back. Well, actually, what we gotta do is figure out where we're gonna mount this little guy. See those two bolts right there and there? Maybe, yeah, you can see them. I think I'm gonna just modify the base of this to fit over them. Because this needs to be, the base of this needs to be grounded anyhow. And then we'll run a wire from this terminal to the starter terminal, which is way down there. And then a wire from there, from that terminal, will go to the underside of the block or the top. It doesn't matter. There's no polarity to this. And then from here, we will probably go right back to maybe one of the mounting bolts for that, or one of the mounting bolts for the filter. One of those four bolts in the middle that's all nice and shiny. Well, I'm gonna go modify that part and tighten that down, and then I'll bring you guys back.
for the exciting part. So I decided to go with the 8-gauge wire instead of the 2-gauge wire because 2-gauge is overkill, 4-gauge is correct, but we're only running this for 30 seconds at a time. I just don't think it matters that much. I did not have the right crimper for these, but what I did, and I think it worked really well, is I took a screwdriver and put it this way, tried to pinch half of the conductors on each side of it, and put it down and pinched it down in the middle, and then squeezed it flat in a vise. They all seem good and strong, so just a little, I guess a little pro tip, if you're ever trying to do one of these and you don't have the right tool, is punch it down the middle, squeeze it over, and I think it'll be just fine, at least for this application. So we're gonna go back over to the back of this thing and try to install some of this. I think I'm gonna not record while I do the one on the back of the starter motor because it is down in the abyss. Yeah, I'll bring you guys back when I'm finishing up some wiring, and then we get to test it and see if this bursts immediately into flames, which would be, you know, at least it'd be compelling footage. You can see the relay underneath there, the red thing, and that goes up to the grid heater and runs off from the power to the battery, which you probably can't see, but that's the starter motor. Sorry, the starter motor, which gets power from the battery. And yeah, that's about it. So I just got to reconnect the battery cable. And if you were doing this with the battery cable connected, it would be a mistake on your end. That's for sure. Yeah, let me get that. Make sure that the battery cable doesn't get eaten by the extremely heavy-duty fan there that's looks like it's eaten some stuff before. Now we're gonna close the back of her and see if this works even a little bit, because I have no idea if this will be effective. I don't know if you can see my breath, but it's definitely cold out here. Cold enough out here for this to work. I'm gonna open up the big door so I don't die of carbon monoxide poisoning instantly. And we're gonna hop up into this old girl. So you can see now I have a temp gauge and it runs at like 140, which seems light. I might need a new thermostat. You got the oil pressure gauge, which somehow already has moisture in it. You got the oil pressure light, which never goes off, so I'm glad I put that in. And then the battery light, and that's about it. Well, I'm gonna start right now, so you can just hear that it won't start right on its own. I'm just cranking it. The glow plug buttons here haven't pushed it. So you can hear it's cranking well. Everything's good. It's just not gonna start. So put you guys right here. You can hear it, so you can watch the light dim, so you know it's working. I'm gonna turn the light out. I'm gonna hold it for 10 seconds and then start cranking. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Well, that was 100% successful. It does seem like once you've held it for about 15 seconds, once you're cranking, you want to let go to give the starter a little more cranking current. But it worked well. Nothing looks to be on fire back here. And no, those wires didn't heat up at all. So I'm glad I didn't go with the overkill wire. Man, I'm thrilled. So basically, I could have mucked around with making the flame start work, but I'm not sure that there isn't something missing, something to put pressure on the return line to keep a little pressurized, whatever. I thought that's what this was, but I'm not positive. I don't have all the stuff. You know, I only have what I had. So I could have replaced that, but that's kind of a weird way to start it. And I was sort of afraid of lighting a fire inside of a rubber hose. And I had seen someone on a forum mention this. This isn't my original idea. I'm sure other people have had it. But I've seen other people mention it. This was a made in USA brand new one. That was $40. You want to make sure it for your application if you're looking at a 12 volt one. The two end pieces I just made out of steel, they were free. The relay was $10. The ends to crimp on were another $10. So for about $60, I guess, it all works. And it uses the same button and same original wiring. So, yeah, everything about this is exactly what I was hoping for. I'm beyond thrilled with this. I'll definitely be making this modification in the future if I have another problem with a diesel engine that doesn't want to start. So I guess for the first time in a long time, is it theoretically practical? It absolutely is. It's practical all the way through. It's relatively inexpensive and relatively easy to do. So if you have a diesel that doesn't have a cold start system or something like that, or the system's old, worn out, hard to get parts for, you can absolutely put a grid heater from a Cummins on there. And man, that worked perfectly because it's... That has not been started today, and it is maybe 20 degrees out here. So, one last thing. The Dynaho has sold. You might have, someone in one of the comments posted about, we kind of sold it out from underneath this guy. We actually had one guy said he was coming the next Monday with a check. One guy said he was coming on Tuesday with a check. Well, a guy showed up on Sunday, and he had a check, so we took it. I feel a little bad for the guy because he did come down and run it and told us he wanted it. But we had been jerked around with that machine for so long that it was really the first person who showed up with the money we were going to sell it to. And we felt like we had to. So we might do a little film of that when we move it out of here, especially the bit where I have to start it up on Monday in 17 degree weather. So that'll be fun and easy. But, we do flip these products. We do sell them. We sold it for $5,200, had about $2,600 into it. So doubled our money on it and made roughly $1 an hour, maybe, but that's neither here nor there because, I had a blast doing it. And if somebody else called me tomorrow and said, "Hey, I've got a huge bulldozer stuck out in the middle of the field. You want it?" Well, I would say in the spring, I want it. And not right now, but yeah, I'd go do it again, even if I made nothing at all, because there's nothing better than playing with big, big old iron. So that's it for this week. Next week, we're starting a whole nother project. There'll probably be a picture up on the Instagram of it, maybe a little sneak peek or something. I'm told that's what the big dogs do on YouTube. So and have a great weekend.